Kia ora, good evening. The impending health and safety law reform bill is expected to become law within the next few months, creating the Health and Safety at Work Act. Government's Working Safer reform package is aimed at bringing down New Zealand's workplace injury and death toll by 25% by 2020. It will also make every workplace responsible for the health and safety of all workers, including directors.
The biggest challenge is if you do get something wrong, you've got quite draconian penalties. You know, the risk of prison or a massive fine for a director of a company is obviously quite motivating. I perhaps don't think that's the right outcome when it comes to enforcement. I fully support the concept of trying to get much better health and safety outcomes for all business, but whether that's the right process, I have a question around.
Where would you say the buck should stop then?
I think it's got to stop with all parties in the chain. That's from the person at the lowest level of the business to the highest level. They really have to actually have an equal share. If the management teams are putting effort into training, support, equipment, and the staff aren't picking up on that, you've got a real challenge. And I think there should be a joint accountability. Right now it's pretty much focused on senior management come directors.
There's a reason why they've done that though, because they can put the finger there.
Yes, they can. And those are the ones that should be creating the change. Understand that fully. But then it puts you in a situation where you probably have to start jettisoning people out of your business if they can't get those basics right. And we're in a bit of a labour shortage right now. That's a real challenge to get the right people without having to perhaps remove people out the door that haven't got the same health and safety mindsets. I think the key thing for people is stop thinking about the cost of getting it right, think about the cost of getting it wrong. That's the key takeaway. Do the hard yards, get right up front, and you will have a much better outcome than not doing it and incurring the drama of the cost, the possible loss of life or the injuries from getting it wrong.
Do you think that in some of the smaller businesses there may be staff that get weeded out as a result of not perhaps fitting that mindset that's required with health and safety in this time?
Yeah, it's a real risk for all of us. I mean, if our staff can't understand or operate at the required level, they probably can't stay in your business. And sometimes it's perceived to be an extra cost to business. And it is a cost up front, but probably has a lowering cost longer term. Because when you get something wrong, the costs of that are immense.
You're already very proactive in the health and safety maintenance of staff.
Yep.
But to try and take them up to the level where you're perhaps not at as much risk as a director or a company owner, how's that shift gone?
We're getting there, but it's a long road. We've got some very good people in this business, and most of them understand it. But the challenge we all have as human beings is that a momentary lapse of focus ruins all the work you've done for the last 5 years. And sadly, we've seen a bit of that in the last few months in our business.
Also working with the environment on farm, again, unpredictable conditions sometimes?
Yeah, very much so. We see some fundamental risks in spreading fertiliser on hills because you can't forecast what the weather's going to do each day or what the moisture content of that clover is 2 metres past the last one you drove. There's some real challenges there. And the same goes with livestock.
In those situations, a lot of those operators are on their own, the sole charge positions when they're driving the trucks. So a lot of it comes down to the individual and making the right call.
Exactly. I mean, they've got to be in the zone thinking-wise to make the right call. It's our job as an employer to try and give them the right training, or understanding, the right tools to do their job properly, but we can't be on their shoulder 24/7. Most of the roles we have are pretty much sole charge. We've got two trucks going to the same farmer's yard, one to deliver fuel and one to pick up livestock, and the performances of those two sectors are quite different when it comes to the number of risks, the number of injuries, etc.
So customer demands are becoming more forthright about what their expectations are for performance from contractors?
Exactly, and that's the way it's got to be. The customer needs to assist in leading this change and putting some expectations down that unless you reach this level or can show you're heading towards this level, I don't want to deal with you. And that gets away from the riffraff, who can put in perhaps ultra-cheap prices but have none of the deemed overheads to support these systems from carrying on business.
As New Zealand's oldest European settlement town, Bluff is quite appropriately the centre of attention for this weekend's heritage celebrations. The seaside town is just 9 years away from celebrating 200 years as a settlement, while still boasting some of the country's finest heritage. Bluff Heritage Day is on Sunday and will offer the public a full-scale tour of the town's most popular attractions.
First stop for people was the Te Rauaharamarae in Bradshaw Street Bluff, where they can pick up a map which gives all the details of all the stops on the tour, and also details of all the guest speakers and all the happenings in, at the Marae and also at the Bluff Maritime Museum. So it's an action-packed day. There's 19 sites on the tour, most of them off the Bluff Heritage Trail, which has been well established by the Bluff History Group over many years. And, you know, there's a great range of sites there, some of architectural significance. There's places like the gun pit emplacement and the radar station at the summit of Bluff Hill, which were obviously constructed during World War II. A whole range of sites, and all come with a very, very interesting story. It's the first time Bluff's been part of Southland Heritage Month, and very appropriate too, being that Bluff is the oldest continuously settled European township in New Zealand. Of course, we're not far off the 2024 milestone of 200 years, so looking forward to that, and this is just a great opportunity for people to come to Bluff, take a tour around most of our heritage sites, and see what Bluff has to offer in the heritage way.
Stay with us. After the break, a taste of culture comes to the South and the week that was. Welcome back. Locals will be spinning a yarn or two during this year's Festival of the Arts in May, and the results will leave Esk Street in stitches. Yarn Bombing is a crafty community project which will see Invercargill's main shopping area clothed in environmentally friendly graffiti.
There's quite a big movement for some of those traditional crafts in the UK and the States, and normally it's a kind of a secret society, and they yarn bomb things secretly, and people get up in the morning and wow, there's some decorations on a tree or something. But because we are doing such a big community event, we've got to be slightly better planned than that, so we're trying to involve a variety of generations and a variety of cultures to brighten and lighten Esk Street for a week.
I would imagine the older generation are quite on board with this, and they already have the skills to do it. What are you doing with the younger ones?
Well, yes, there are lots and lots of grannies and aunties, but we're hoping that we can upskill some of the school children as well. I'm working with the Children's Art Experience to see if we can get some of their Peace Haven residents to work with some school children and give them the skills, and then display their work, of course. Plus, we're going to have some workshops, and we've already got two classes at Southland Girls High School who are upcycling and making their own yarn, and then they're going to use that to decorate as well. We'll have some basic patterns of sizes and shapes that we need, and if people don't want to donate their wool but would like to do something themselves, then come and get a pattern from Wool World, because the ladies there are supporting us, and they will give you a small discount if you buy some yarn. And they'll have patterns and things for you, plus they'll be on the Facebook page and via email if you wish.
What exactly is going to be covered here in Esk Street?
Ideally everything, but we'll have to see what kind of input we get from community groups. Hopefully the parking meters and the bollards, some seats, love to do the rubbish bins because they're always a bit unattractive, and the trees. I'd really like some crocheted flowers, so it's not all about knitting. I'm more of a crochet person myself, so crocheted flowers, we can string them up around the trees, we can have pom-poms dangling, we can do doilies actually, if anybody's got doilies they'd like to donate, you know, their nana's doilies. I've still used them at my place. we can sew them together, and they look fantastic. They look like spidery, spiderwebby things. They're wonderful. Old jerseys, we'll pull your old jersey apart and we'll recycle that into fantastic, colourful, anything. Think Doctor Who scarves or whatever you like.
What sort of skill level or quality are you looking for in the final product?
Don't mind at all. If you've got somebody who still remembers how to do rat's tails, you know, with the little cotton reel in the... do some of those, because we can wrap just about anything. Wrapping is fine. If you've dropped a few stitches, it doesn't matter. We'll sew it together. Just whatever you can do would be fantastic.
And there's a public meeting for all crafty enthusiasts who want to find out more about what's involved in the project. That's at Venture Southland on March the 18th. The Southern Wild Foods Festival gave Southerners a taste of culture last month, but this weekend is hoping to give them an entire mouthful. The Multicultural Food Festival is back again tomorrow and is offering people the chance to taste a variety of ethnic foods and sit back with some good Southland entertainment.
This is happening at Stadium Southland again, and it's just because of it's getting more popular with people coming forward to have a good time with the family and friends. So because it's a free entry, we usually get more people coming in to the event.
And it's not about making money, it's about sharing the culture with the community.
Yes, our idea is to give the people what different cultures are offering from. So we're just trying to bring them together and showing them the culture which every person in Invercargill is having.
What can people expect if they come along to this year's event?
It's a multi-cuisine which we have been offering all the time. So instead of having just about 20 stalls, we have about 30 stalls, food stalls having here. So we're trying to give them more different cuisine which they could come and have a taste of it. We got two stalls from Indian. It's one of them is Little India and Curry Guru. They have been specialized with spicy food. It's just a different cuisine. So they could expect kebabs, they could have some burgers, some pastries, something with pie and a lot of other stuff. What we're trying to do is to have some Bollywood dance, some Chinese dancing, because it's just close to Chinese New Year. We thought of having that, and we got a couple of bands performing and some kids who are ready to perform there as well.
And now let's take a look at the weather.
Your forecast on Q is brought to you by Environment Southland. Environment Southland wants to know what you think about our recreational water areas. Where do you go? What do you do? And your thoughts about the water quality. You could win one of five $100 vouchers simply by completing their survey. The survey will help them find out whether the water is being tested in the right places and how the service can be improved. Complete the survey online by going to Environment Southland's website or pick up a hard copy from Environment Southland, the Southland District Council, Gore District Council, Invercargill City Council or Public Health South.
And here's your weather for Friday the 13th of March. Auckland, a high of 26 today, Wellington 22, Christchurch saw a high of 27 today and Queenstown 18. Dunedin 18 today, Gore 13, Invercargill 14 and Stewart Island a high of 13 today. And tomorrow's forecast for Southland, fine with nor'west breezes. Riverton a high of 16, Wyndham and Winton both highs of 18, 16 for Tuatapere tomorrow, 18 for Gore and 17 for Invercargill. Tiano a high of 19 tomorrow and 20 for Queenstown. And to the marine forecast for Fovo, westerly 20 knots becoming northwest 15 knots, rough sea easing with 2 metres southwest swell. And Pusiga, westerly 15 knots becoming northwest 15 knots, very rough sea in the south, southwest swell rising to 3 metres. And to the long range forecast, Sunday fine with increasing high cloud, northerly breezes. Monday, a period of rain with a southerly change, and Tuesday, a few showers with cold southerlies. And that's it from us this week. We'll leave you now with some of the images that told the stories of the week. From the news team, good night.
I seem to recognize your face. Haunting, familiar, yeah. I can't seem to place it. Cannot find the candle of thought to light your name. Lifetimes are catching up with me. All these changes take place. I wish I'd seen the place, but no one's there taking me. Hearts and thoughts, they fade away. Hearts and thoughts, they fade away. I swear I recognize
up on the shelf. I changed by not changing at all. Small town predicts my fate. Perhaps that's what no one wants to see.